Okay, as we are lucky that Thibault is actually here, and as Thibault was complaining that there are not enough calculations on the blackboard and just ideas, and he wants to see the calculation part. So I have in anticipation that he may be here nevertheless today. So I actually, the lecture is going to be in two parts. The first half hour I will do very fast. I will highlight points which I would have done in greater detail to conclude the series of three lectures. But the other part, 1 hour, is going just to be about anomalies. I'm going to discuss anomalies, how you have global anomalies, how you have local anomalies, and do specific calculations, which I think are instructive. And in everything else I told you, there are open problems also there, but the area is much better studied and much better known than here. So what were the things that we passed through in the two former lectures? We discussed that semi-classical geometry captures two averages, which are very small and are of the order of e to the minus s. One of them was, well, both of them were related actually to noise. One of them was related just to the behavior, the long time behavior of a two-point correlation function. And we discussed chaotic case and integrable or semi-integrable cases. We saw a large variety of possibilities for the value of the noise as a function of the entropy. And we saw that semi-classical geometry gives correctly these very small numbers. We saw, however, that semi-classical geometry fails to give more exclusive information, in particular, how the correlation functions behave at any given time and not just averaging there. So this appeared once about 10 years ago in the context of black hole information paradox and reappeared in the case of the ER equal EPR paradox, where once again it seemed that geometry may not play a role, but actually we have seen here the geometry can capture a very small quantity, which in this case was related to the EPR structure of various objects, in particular eternal black hole, and then deviations from that. And I won't go into any more. Then I said that I would like to study more about singularities. Of course, also the black hole has a singularity inside it. And of course, also the firewall is a singularity. But I wanted also to discuss other type of singularities. Now, we know that in string theory, singularities which are time-like actually are resolved from time to time. There are examples in string theory where such singularities are resolved. And I don't know how the camera can do it, but you should close your eyes. And I will tell you, because I don't want you to see as I flip through everything, and I'll tell you when you can open them when I reach my target, okay? So my advice is close your eyes. If you insist on keeping them open, your problem. Okay, so I wanted to reach here. Actually, that's true. I want ones to reach there. And we know that in string theory, any concept that we know as unambiguous when one probes nature by point particles has an example where it becomes ambiguous, or if you wish, symmetric, that's a nicer word, when you probe nature by probes which are extended. The earliest and most famous one is just simple distance. You would think that if we have one dimension which is compactified on radius r and one on radius 1 over r, that the two are totally different. If you do quantum mechanics of particles on these objects, the spectrum is completely different. When you do string theory, that is not the case. And as you know, that is a tip of the iceberg of a class of symmetries known as T-dualities. And there is a whole group, very long structure. A lot of it penetrated into mathematics under mirror symmetry. And there are a lot of ambiguities of that nature, an infinite number of them, discrete infinity of them. Then we have examples of series where the target space has different topology, and nevertheless, string theory would give the same answer. We have that for small cases, and we have it when the things are small. I won't go through all the examples, we don't have here the time, but just remember that if I write down a WZW model on level one on a certain group manifold, then I can describe it either by the group manifold, whose dimension would be the dimension of the group, or I can define it on the Cartan subalgebra, which dimension is the rank of the group. So you have here an example of A, the topology being different, because the topology of U1 to the R is different than the topology of the different groups, and the dimension is different, because it's dimension G in one case and R in the other case. So we have this concept of topology ambiguous. The number of dimensions we know is ambiguous, large or small. In the first lecture, I spent time about how four dimensions with a certain set of degrees of freedom can describe 10 dimensions with another set of degrees of freedom. Then you can go on and do commutativity. We know that we have examples where for a certain degree, set of degrees of freedom, we can consider the system on a manifold which is commutative, and for another set of degrees of freedom, the manifold is not commutative. You can look at associativity. There are examples in the presence of fluxes where the manifold may be associative or not, and you would get the same answers. And then you go to singularities. So the simplest case in string theory, when it's small, you take a C equal one model, you look at a circle of a certain radius, or you look at an orbifold of a different radius. The orbicircle is just the, okay, here I don't have, but you can use your imagination, just take here. You just let the target space contain a piece in it, which is a circle where you have identified the angles theta and minus theta. So by doing that, you have objects which on a circle were open strings. If you attach them to these points, they become closed strings. And they produce a twisted sector. You can study the whole model. But the main thing is that this object has, of course, two fixed points, at zero and at pi. So this is actually the line with these two fixed points. And this object has a time-like singularity in quantum mechanics. However, you know that when it has a certain radius, it is exactly equivalent to a certain circle with another radius. So that is already one example. Then there are other examples which are more sophisticated, which I won't enter in, where you go into certain points, you generate extra massless particles, and then you have a different type of topology and different type of singularity structure. So actually, I don't know of any concept in mathematics which has not become ambiguous or symmetric when there are at least examples of where it has become ambiguous or symmetric in the presence of extended objects as probes. And I think that's very interesting. And I think it's a great pity that we don't have a unified picture of that, but each case we solve on its own. While I would imagine that eventually mathematicians would teach, or we would teach them, or they would teach us, how to have a unified picture which explains how come all these ambiguities come out. Now, as part of these ambiguities, I would like now to look into cosmology. And I would make here the claim that one can look on a cosmology which seems to have no singularities. Time goes from minus infinity to plus infinity. And you just lie on your, how do you call it, hammock? And that's it. Nothing ever happens to you. And on the other hand, you have another dual frame in which you have a drastic end of time, and in which there is a catastrophe, everything explodes. So you have two different pictures of the same phenomena in the bulk. So this is a very interesting thing, and we study that with José Barbón in quite a lot of detail to try and understand how come it is possible to have both these pictures. Now, we know that in general, when we do singularities and when we study singularities in a normal theory, the fact that they appear in our theory is a reflection of our ignorance. We don't know that there is quantum mechanics. We think about classical physics and we miss that there is quantum mechanics. We miss massless excitations. But when we increase our knowledge, these singularities are not there anymore. General relativity is a trickier object because it has in it horizons. And under the skirts of horizons, maybe some things can be hidden. They are, it goes, as you know, under their general principles, which are not again proven from anywhere, but you impose very general censorship issues in hope that such things are all such singularities are always protected by horizons. But does it have to happen? Does it not happen? This is not obvious. And there are a set of examples where this actually does not happen. Namely, you can show that using again ADS-CFT as a tool, that there is no need that the singularity be there. So the way I distribute the half hours, I want some things to remain with you. So one thing I want to remain with you is this picture of the multiverse. So you have here various islands. In this case, the islands where we can live. And one minimum could be better than the other. And we try somehow to jump from one to the other. And in this case, I also capture the idea that, okay, you also want to live on the other minimum. Now, in general, when you have a field theory, which has two minima with no gravity, then we know that there is a mechanism by which you go from this minimum to this minimum. And this was analyzed by many people and by the Russian group, by the US groups. And the mechanism actually comes a little bit, even the intuition from statistical mechanics is, okay, let's say you are sitting in this, you have a wave functional, which is concentrated around this state. You try and stay there. Now, this is not an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. You must, if you just write here the wave functional with no components here, it will not be a wave functional, an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian. And then the idea is that suddenly a bubble of the true vacuum will appear. And the question is, will this vacuum, will the revolution succeed or will the revolution fail? So this is an attempt to make a revolution. If it will, the bubble will increase, the revolution will be successful. If it will shrink, it will fail. Now, how does the analysis go? We know that if you do, you create such a bubble of the right phase in the wrong phase, and I'm not talking, no gravity involved, then you are in a situation where you gain energy proportional to the volume of the system, but you lose energy proportional to the derivatives that you have to pay for if you go from one phase to the other phase. And here I took what is called the thin-wall approximation, where it's very drastic and all the derivatives are concentrated here. You can also make them more blurred and do analysis on what happens. In any case, one effect goes like the volume and one effect goes like the surface. So this means that there will be a revolution which will succeed. It could be that if the bubble which forms is too small, it will contract again. But eventually there will be a bubble for which no matter what the parameters of the problem are, let's say some phi force theory, so you have lambda 2 and lambda 4, no matter what the parameters are, this is going to, there will be a fluctuation which is large enough and it will take over and everybody will be, the whole system will move to the other vacuum. So this situation of tunneling from one vacuum to the other is what happens in field theory, and it's not unexpected because both of these actually live in the same Hilbert space. There was never a doubt that the state here is just some excited state of what exists here. Now, what Coleman and De Lucia studied what happens when you add gravity. And when at the time the cosmological constant was supposed to be zero, so the question was what happened when the vacuum energy was larger than zero. Now, actually, what is interesting for us is what happens when you tunnel between two vacua, both of which have, let's say, a negative cosmological constant, because we are using ADS as a tool. In that case, what you see is not what you get. And the main reason is, let's say you are sitting here, or even here, and you ask, am I stable or not stable? So in ADS, there is a major feature, as you know well, that the surface and the area and the volume scale in the same manner. So once you know what the parameters of the model are, you can't have a victory by having a very large, going to a very large scale. The scale, the issue of if this will work or not work is just determined by the parameters. So you may sit in a vacuum here, but in that vacuum, you will nevertheless not go here because the parameters are such that it doesn't allow it. There is also what is called the Breiten-Müller-Friedman bound. Even if you sit at a point here and you think you have a tachyon or an unstable direction, if the tachyon doesn't have a large enough mass squared, you will also be stable. But what is important for the discussion here, what happens is that generically, unless you do very fine tuning, and this was shown in the paper of Coleman De Lucia with calculations, that if you go from here to here, you crunch. It's not that you will now go to a new vacuum, no matter how many victims you had, but at least you settle in a new vacuum. No, you crunch. So crunch means that if you do the semi-classical calculation till the region of validity of your calculation, it seems like you're forming a curvature singularity. And afterwards, you're outside the validity of the calculation and you don't know what happens. So ADS is a very good place to try and study what happens when you have singularities inside and what does the holographic theory tell you about it, because the holographic, this is the words I said, because the holographic theory contains the total non-perturbative thing. Here I mentioned that in flat space, a large enough bubble will always beat the surface. In ADS, no. It depends on the parameters of the problem. Sometimes it will, and sometimes it will not. And then we went, again, I advise you to close your eyes. We made a setup in which one can study this. And one particular case is you can take the ADS space and make a de Sitter foliation of it. And when you do that, you have inside here somewhere a crunch in the Lorentzian part. I don't have, again, time to go into this diagram in detail. It just you start with the Euclidean part, then you build here the Hartle-Hawking wave function, and then you move from here to the Lorentzian part by doing the analytic continuation. And again, I invite you to look at the papers for all of that. The bottom line, in the time I'm dedicating to it, is this system, which it has ADS in it, and has generically a singularity in here. It consists of gravity, matter, and matter has an OD, 1 symmetry in the Lorentzian part and OD plus 1 symmetry in the Euclidean part. So if you have that symmetry, then generically you have a crunch solution inside. You demonstrate by looking at this coupled system of equations. Then you go to the boundary and you have some type of theory on the boundary. And this theory on the boundary to study is easier than to study black holes because you find out that the singularity reaches the boundary, or if you wish, the UV degrees of freedom of the field theory in a finite time. So there is a representation of the problem on the field theory side. And you try to see what is a representation. And the lessons are the following. You can have a theory on the boundary which has a relevant operator. If the relevant operator has a positive sign, so let's think of a mass squared, let's say that you have m squared phi squared, this theory now, when you go back into the bulk, will have a singularity in it, but the singularity will not be a crunch, but would be that, as you know, what is the IR limit of a theory which has a mass? You go just to the vacuum state. If you have some interesting topology, okay, you will get more than just a vacuum state, but generically, you just end up with a vacuum state, which means that in the bulk, you have drained out a piece of the geometry and you create what is called the bubble of nothing. So this is the situation when you add a positive relevant operator. When you add a negative relevant operator, you may succeed that in this new vacuum, you still have many degrees of freedom. If you have there many degrees of freedom, you have a non-trivial geometry also here. And it is this geometry which in the bulk has a singularity. I'm not showing here again the details, I'm telling you just the fact. So you have here on the sitter space, but no gravity, just an expanding universe, you find yourself in a situation where you have a well-defined theory. So the boundary theory tells you there is no problem, everything goes well. The bulk has in it a singularity. How do you see on the boundary that there is a problem? You change coordinates, and I think I gave a talk about this several years ago here, and you can expose that singularity. But if you use this conformal boundary, this is a bread and butter spontaneous ON, let's call it, or some other spontaneous global symmetry theory. And it looks perfectly well on the boundary. It has a singularity in the bulk. So that means that you can try and reconstruct details of what happens in the bulk. And we took a quantum mechanical example in a paper. And I think the thing to remember about that, you would imagine that the term R phi squared, which appears every time you have the conformal field theory, and then you perturb it, but you have the term R phi squared, you would imagine that in quantum mechanics it disappears. But actually, to our surprise, we didn't see it noticed before, it does not, because the curvature goes to zero at the same rate as the conformal coupling, which multiplies it, goes to infinity, and the product is finite. Usually, in four dimensions, you are used to have a 1/6 multiplying the R phi squared. But there is a general dimension structure of that, and when d goes to 1, that is quantum mechanics, the coupling explodes, the curvature goes to 0, and the product is finite. So you can play with this and see how you do diagnostics of a theory which on the boundary has no problems, which means it doesn't have problems, while in the bulk it does. And this, then I would say in one word, you can also have a theory where the theory has an operator, for example, marginal or relevant, which is unstable. If it's unstable, also the bulk is not curable. So you will have a problem on the boundary and you will have a problem on the bulk. There is an interesting number theory problem which arises if you allow this thing to oscillate. A butterfly effect, like the Kapitsa problem of the inverted pendulum. And actually that has very interesting structure in number theory, I won't discuss it. What is the point which I wanted to discuss for further reference? The point for further reference, okay, here I just told you the facts. For further reference, the point I wanted to discuss is this. Okay, I told you about t-duality. You all know about the story that if you have a circle, it's R or 1 over R. Now tell me, how do our brains know? Because after all, the universe could be in one direction, a circle. We have no evidence that it's not. We don't have any evidence that it is. So let me announce now that the discovery was just made in some new experiment that you never heard about, and they just discovered that there is a circle. So how do we decide if it's R or 1 over R? How do we know to say that? Okay, in my opinion, the reason is the way we are built by looking at local observables. This is our structure. So for us, the momentum modes and not the winding modes are the natural probes of the system. So our distinction of R and 1 over R goes by momentum modes. We think through localized wave packets or local plane or plane waves. Winding modes are not built into us. Now, our feeling is that the same thing happens when you have the two dual descriptions of this singularity in the bulk. That is, if you have probes which are local, then you will not know, let me do here, again, I will jump on all this, I will just use this. If you have probes which are local, you will, and you live in the sitter, you will not know that there is a crunch. You can go on your hammock forever. If you build probes which are very large and increase in size together as the Hubble constant, grows, and your world volume, even though it's not gravitationally coupled, but it just grows, if you use such large observables, we believe that you would have doomsday people saying that they would know about the end. So this would be the analogy, and to me it's an open problem to identify these observables. What are the winding-like modes which would tell us that indeed a catastrophe is going to happen? In the coordinate systems in which you see a catastrophe, the oystresses which would not see it would be objects which would shrink much faster than the Hubble constant on the scale. So they would never notice, because they are shrinking, they would not notice the imminent catastrophe. So to me, that's an important question to understand. Is it true that indeed the boundary theory says that the singularity can be cured without anything extra happening, as it would seem, or not? And I think this is one of the keys to look at it. Okay, now in the last 5 minutes, I discuss the issue of complexity. I defined complexity last time. I'm glad in private to give people again, tell them what complexity is. And it was supposed to be a measure if it's what happens, what is the structure of the singularity? And there was a conjecture which was born by looking at black holes for long times, that if complexity increases, then everything is okay. No singularities are formed in the process. However, if complexity decreases, then for a black hole, you would expect the horizon to be like a firewall. And this is what I told you last time. So we asked ourselves, what happens for various types of singularities? And what we found, the general structure, again, please close your eyes if you don't want to get a... What we found that in the cases we studied of singularities, and we had three types of singularities, that the complexity decreases towards the singularity. Of course, all the calculations cannot continue when you're string scale, because then your tools are not there. But till you reach scales which are string scales and curvatures which are of the order of string scales, appropriate 1/1, then you find that the complexity decreases. And one case is, for example, the Kasner, which universe, in that case, that's the most trivial example, because you just take the world volume and shrink it to t equals zero. So here, when I say decrease, increase, it's toward t equals zero. So you have to go back from positive t to t equals zero. This is the metric of the problem. This is a metric on the boundary. You can extend it because it's Ricci flat to the bulk. This is one extension which has the same boundary. You do the analysis of calculating the complexity. I told you last time you use the idea that you have an extremal volume surface. Never mind the how. The final result of this thing is that as you approach t equals zero, the complexity decreases. And this is the volume of the CFT times the number of degrees of freedom times the cutoff you put, because you don't want to reach the singularity itself. So you're approaching it, but you're doing the calculations before the singularity. And this reminds us of, when trying to think about it, reminded us of the structures in models which Thibault used to play with. And those are the structures of which we don't know, again, these works of Berezinski, Lifshitz, and who did I forget? Khalatnikov, I forgot, and Khalatnikov. These works, we never knew if they are generic or not, but they had the property that the system, as you went towards the singularity, developed much larger time derivatives than spatial derivatives. So if you have a lattice picture, the system looked like in the strong coupling on the lattice. Each problem lives on its own, a quantum mechanics of the lattice. And this, as a state, is a very simple state. So its complexity is indeed very low. So somehow, the fact that we got it for Kasner may be less surprising, but we also got it for the cases I described before, which were the singularities sitting inside ADS. In all these cases, we found the singularities to decrease. The reason that the singularity decreases, if you wish, was the A theorem. Namely, in the computations themselves, and I will, this will be the last thing. Again, please turn, shut your eyes. Okay, and let me show the results of the calculation. So the results were that if you looked at the extremal volume, you found that the contributions you get from the part which is the UV part are of what I've written here. What you get from the IR part, these decrease with time, these increase with time when you sum them up together. The reason that the sum decreases is because the number of degrees of freedom in the infrared is smaller than the number of degrees of freedom in the UV. And the process has in it a constant flow of degrees of freedom from the UV to the IR. So this is the final answer that you get, and it decreases. So with the prescription that the volume is what is supposed to be the complexity, we found for four types of singularities, they all had one common feature, the complexity decreased, which somehow gives you the picture of a system which is decoupled into many different space-time points. So maybe one step into getting a feeling of what singularities look like using the tools which actually are tools on the boundary field theory. And with this, I actually even fulfilled my promise, and I'm glad in private to discuss more, but this concludes this part of the singularity. I would maybe just say again, to me it was very surprising that we can live with a theory which in the bulk has a singularity. This is not what I would have expected. Usually we wait for the knight on the white horse to come and save us. Quantum mechanics, something, string theory. Here it seems that you can live without it. However, as I told you, there is the issue of what probes we use. And it could well be that with probes which we are not used, we have not yet developed in these theories, which are long extended probes, one would actually see the singularity even when you are on your hammock thinking you will never see the singularity. Okay, now I want to discuss anomalies. So when Thibault originally asked me to take essentially my Blaise Pascal lectures. So this was part of one of my Blaise Pascal lectures, and it was more to educate than for an advanced audience. So anomalies, kinkiness, whatever, plays a role in our physics understanding. And in string theory, as you know, there is the central charge minus 26 and the central charge minus 15, which come out of an anomaly, play a very important role in how we construct string theory. And the open question I want to discuss will be related to that. In gate theories, it took many more decades to appreciate the fact that you can't write down any gate theory you want. There are some restrictions on what you can do. And one of the restrictions goes under the name of gauge anomalies. And I would like to discuss simple examples of this and give an understanding of what happens, because physicists hate authority. So if somebody tells you, okay, you can't quantize the theory, they say, why not? I want to quantize it. So what punishment will you suffer in the situation where we'll ignore these anomalies? Now, in general, how do you get to anomalies? So you have a certain, our way we are, maybe this will change. Okay, we'll start here. So one set of very interesting lectures could have been, should we really continue and write Lagrangians and actions? This has been a very successful way of doing physics, but as you know, we are very ungrateful, and everything that succeeds, we afterwards say, maybe we should have done it differently and ignore it. So one point of view, which is you have heard probably many times recently, is maybe one doesn't need Lagrangians, or not that you don't need them, but there are circumstances where even if you want them, they aren't there. You have no idea how to write them down. Now, the usual way, we write first a classical Lagrangian. We identify its symmetries. Okay, now we can be pleased by it having symmetry, or we may not care if it has symmetry, but it seems that it, in order to understand at least the basic interactions which we observe in nature, assuming a symmetry, which many call now redundant, which is gate symmetry, was a very useful way to do computations and to confront them with experiment. So we have spent a lot of time in writing down Lagrangians of systems which are gauge invariant. And they contain spin 1 particles, and they contain spin 1/2 particles, and they contain spin 0 particles. Now, the symmetry played a very important role, especially when one tried to take into account the full quantum mechanical structure of the theory, that is, do renormalization. When one does renormalization, one finds out that this, what is called the quantum Lagrangian, which is a true one, cannot preserve the symmetries of the classical Lagrangian. Now, sometimes maybe it cannot preserve at all. Sometimes you may be in a situation where this Lagrangian has several symmetries. And by preserving one, you can do it, but you cannot preserve others. And then you are faced with a choice. Maybe I don't give a damn about all of them. Maybe I want to preserve one and not the other, and what would be the consequences of doing that? So I want to exemplify these in simple cases. I will start with a quantum mechanical case. Now, in quantum mechanical case, you can say you talked about renormalization, you talked about the infinities. How will you see any type of anomaly in quantum mechanics? So actually, when one discovered anomalies, gauge anomalies, they came in two parts. One wrote down some partition function, and the question was, this could be some regularized partition function. The original one had a symmetry, a full symmetry. And you ask, what happens to that when you apply to it a gauge transformation. So how is Z of A of G related to the original Z of A you had? Now, the gauge group, as a gauge group, is of course a local symmetry, but itself has a local structure and a global structure. And I will show here in the example in quantum mechanics, we will actually discuss the gauge, the local gauge symmetry, but its global part. Global not in the sense of that it doesn't change with space-time coordinate, but it's part of the global structure of the group. Because the group of gauge transformation is some group. And this group has local structure, let's say near the identity, but it can also have some non-trivial topology. And you can ask, how does this object behave under large gauge transformations? And this is the anomaly I want to discuss. Now, the system I'm going to take will first have a quantized gauge, and then the gauge will not be, the gauge field first will be not quantized and then will be quantized. So it's a very, given the time, again, I'll take a very simple system. I'll make it abelian. You can discuss the same thing for non-abelian systems. And the reference for this is work done together with Shmuel Elitzur, Yitzhak Frischmann, and Adam Schwimmer. Some of them say it's too trivial to be worthwhile even to mention. I will mention it. So the Lagrangian we are going to take will have a complex, will have a fermion. So it will be a fermion psi of t, and it will be coupled. So there is only time, because it's quantum mechanics, with the t component of a to psi of t. This will be the Lagrangian. Because I am in the appropriate number of dimensions, I don't need to worry about gamma 5 or gamma 0 and so on. Just they are all defined to be ones. Now, this system is invariant under certain symmetries. It has a gauge symmetry and it has a global symmetry. And the gauge symmetry will construct, so it has a global part and a local part. So what is the gauge symmetry? So there is a U1 local gauge symmetry. And that is, if I take psi of t and I multiply it as one is used to by e to the lambda t, that would be, I take psi of t to and multiply it by that phase. I take psi bar and I multiply it by this phase and shift a of t into a of t plus dt of lambda t. This Lagrangian, as written, is invariant under that symmetry. It is also invariant under a global symmetry. This is the symmetry I will present to clash with. And that symmetry is take and interchange psi and psi bar, and take a and move it into minus a. That is what you would expect from charge conjugation, so let's call it charge conjugation. This is a global symmetry. I do that symmetry at one point. I take psi to psi bar and a to minus a. Now, in order to give this interesting structure, because I want to build a case where there is an anomaly. So I have to give some structure. And the structure is, I'm going to put t on some, on some region from 0 to capital T, and I'm going to impose periodic boundary conditions on the gauge field here. So I have T goes to the t goes from 0 to t, where from the point of view of the gauge field, I want to impose periodic boundary conditions. Okay, so now I won't show you, but it's a trivial exercise you can do for yourself. Just interchange psi and psi bar, put a to minus a, and then try to get back your original Lagrangian. Remember the anti-commutation relations of the psi's and psi bar, and remember the psi and psi bar, the anti-commutation relation is one. You will retrieve back this model after doing this. So therefore, you know that you have two symmetries at the classical level. Okay. Now, just note for a moment that when you look at a system, you write down, which is also actually modern today, you write down all line integrals, all things that sit in that system. So for example, let us consider the Wilson loop. So I can write a loop, or in this language, some people sometimes call it the Polyakov loop, because it goes in the temporal direction. Let's look at this object from 0 to t, a of t, dt. Now, let us check its gauge invariance properties. So if I substitute in here, I substitute this, I have the first term is the term, so now let's do the substitution. So I'm going to get the original term, which is exponent of I a dt from 0 to t. And I'm going to get a second term, sorry, it will be a product. And the second term, because I have a total derivative here, is going to be I times lambda at t minus lambda at 0. Now here you will see the structure of the gauge group coming into play. I could say that I wanted the gauge group be such that at the edges, both lambda of t and lambda of 0 should be 0. Namely, I'm interested only in local gauge transformations, which near they start and they end at the same point, for example, the identity. I don't allow them to change. In that case, for those transformations and the class of all lambdas which obey this, this will be the local part of the local gauge invariance. The Wilson loop, which is the quantity here, is invariant under them. Another quantity, however, which would be in another set of gauge transformations, which would be invariant under them, would be the large gauge transformations. And I could allow myself that lambda of t minus lambda of 0 not be the same, but be 2 pi n. This would also keep the theory invariant. Now W and this action here is invariant under both. So I have the full gauge transformations here. Okay, and however, there is already one lesson to learn. Usually, and I will do it in the second example when we go to two dimensions, usually when you quantize a theory, or a nice way to quantize the theory is by going to the gauge A naught equals 0. There you can have Gauss's law, and you have the Hamiltonian, and then you diagonalize your theory by submitting your wave functional to Gauss's law. And by this, you reduce the number of degrees of freedom from d to d minus 1 with a naught, and by applying Gauss's law, I will repeat it on the states, you get d minus 2 degrees of freedom. Okay, but in this system, is it possible to always go to the gauge a naught equals 0? The answer is not, because one of the things which defines the system is the value of the Wilson loop you have. Now, what is possible, you can take any configuration A of t and turn it into a time-independent gauge, into a time-independent field. So any field that I give you as a background, or afterwards I'll integrate over A of t, can always be reduced to a constant. And the value of the constant, this can always be taken by a legal gauge transformation, by a local one. It will be here 1 over t, if you wish, the average of A of t dt from 0 to t. Okay, another place where this average comes in, but for a different reason. And this object, dA bar dt, by definition, vanishes, because I've taken out all the t dependence in it. Now, how will A bar change under the residual gauge transformations I have, which are the gauge transformations which have this property? So I can take, for example, a local gauge transformation, which could start from 0, let's say, and end at 2 pi n. How would A of t change under this gauge transformation? So this, as you see, is part of the local part of the global. This is part of the global part of the local gauge transformation. Because at time 0 and at time t, it has different values. Cannot be deformed to the identity. So under this, you will see that A bar goes to A bar plus 2 pi n over t. So unless you are in a situation where already this object here has been arranged to be a 2 pi n, you cannot take and go back to 0. So you are in a situation where you have a remnant of the gauge group, which you have to maintain as a symmetry, and has to remain a symmetry of your partition function. And that is the one where A bar gets shifted in such a way. The Wilson loop and this will have different values, depending on with what background I put. I cannot go to A bar equals 0 unless I'm in a very special configuration. Okay, so these are the constraints we have. And now we have to go ahead and calculate the partition function. Now, there are two ways to do it, and this is part of the question I'd like afterwards to ask you. There is one part which is very complicated on some scale, and that is, at least for someone learning quantum mechanics, would be complicated. And that just do the integral over psi and psi bar and see how the thing depends on A, using the Lagrangian. I will show how to do that. But then the same thing can be done with a Hamiltonian. And the Hamiltonian gives it the answer in two lines. While the Lagrangian, as you will see, if one likes long calculations, it is a long calculation. So now let's do the functional integral over psi and psi bar. If these were bosonic degrees of freedom, we have a Gaussian, the Lagrangian is Gaussian in the field psi, we would have a determinant to the power minus a half, let's say, if it would be one real field. Because these are Grassmann variables, you get the opposite sign. So what you would have here, when you calculate the functional integral, you would get that z of a bar, remember, I used gauge freedom as much as I could. I fixed this down to the integer part, the appropriate, I kept the fractional part of the value of the background field, which I cannot modify anymore by gauge transformations. It's gauge invariant. And I look how the partition function depends on that. And this was the result by integrating d psi, d psi bar, and we had an exponent of I s over h bar, and we just went ahead and did it. So this result is the determinant of the linear derivative minus dt plus I a bar. Okay, and if you wanted some infinity in quantum mechanics, you got it here, because this object here needs regularization. It's an infinite product, this determinant, so you need to regularize it. So the question is, comes now, how to regularize it? And now we keep in mind that there were two symmetries, which at this stage we treat the same. We don't prefer one to the other. We would like to maintain that Z A bar gauged under the global part of the local gauge be equal to the original Z of A, that is under the 2 pi n over t. I want the symmetry. And I also want that my regular partition function be Z of minus A. And the question is, can I keep these two things together? This was a global symmetry. This is the global part of a local symmetry. A global, again, from the point of view of the topology, not in the sense that it's a global transformation. And can we do it? Okay, that's a question. You will see in the Hamiltonian calculation, it's very easy. Immediately you see what is possible and what is not possible. Here, you need to work. So there is one way in which one does the calculation in higher dimensions, and that's called Pauli-Villars. What you do is you take the system at hand, you add to the system at hand a mass term. The mass term, by definition, obeys no matter global, local part of the symmetry of the gauge group. It's always there. And if you look at this object, you have changed the theory. But then what you do is, you take the mass to infinity. And when you take the mass to infinity, you can do that, which means physically you have decoupled that particle. Now, we will see in the short part of the second part of the second part, is that you can't always decouple massive particles. When there is an anomaly present, the revenge will come at you. But here there is no anomaly because I took care that all the symmetries, the gauge symmetries, be preserved. So I can just take m to infinity and I can see what happens. So now, in order to be able to do that, one actually needs to add a few Pauli-Villars. I will write to you how this goes on. And see if there is some combination which will give you a finite result. Whatever that finite regularized result is, you're sure it's going to be invariant under all types of gauge transformations. And you are at its mercy if it's also invariant under A goes to minus A. In this way, you do it, you don't prove that there is no other regularization which would preserve both. But on the other hand, you respect the old tradition of using Pauli-Villars, which is an indicator that that's the case. As I told you, when we go to the Hamiltonian formulation, you will see immediately what is possible and what is not. You won't have to go through the phase space of all possible regularizations. Okay, so what do you have in the case here? So the partition function Z of alpha, which is regularized using Pauli-Villars, you actually have here two masses you need in order to get the finite result. So you take both to infinity, and what you have here is determinant of minus t plus I alpha bar multiplied by the determinant of minus dt plus I alpha bar plus m1, which will be taken to infinity to the power alpha 1. And if this tells you, if you wish, alpha 1 here tells you how many species of Pauli-Villars particles you want to take. But this is a mathematical regularization, so it doesn't have to be an integer. But in principle, it would tell you the number of species, because the determinant would go up by the number of species. Then you would have here determinant of minus dt plus I a bar plus m2, all this to the power alpha 2. Now, it turns.
Why do you have m1 and not I m1? If I add m psi bar psi, this adds to a, not to I.
If I add. No, I need. The truth is, I don't remember now. But as far as I remember, this is a correct thing, and I would have to justify to you why, how to do that, why to do that. This turns out to be finite when 1 plus alpha 1 plus alpha 2 vanishes, and when alpha m1 plus alpha 2 m2 is 0. So you see that if I have here an I, in the conditions it would fall. So it now one can show it in detail. And what you get here is, this is for you now, just so one sees. So there is a limit of m1 goes to infinity. The limit of m2 goes to infinity. And then you have a product for n going from minus n1 to plus n2, where n1 go to infinity and n2 go to infinity. I mean, nobody tried to play here double scalings. I don't know if there are several ways you would do it. At this stage, it looks like it doesn't matter how they play. Maybe there would be a little more structure if one would relate the various ways of going to infinity. In any case, you get this product of, so you have a free field, so you know you have 2 pi, these are fermions, so when you do functional integrals, we have something going from 0 to t. So for the gauge field, I emphasized it's periodic, but if you want to preserve the quantization for the fermions, you have to do anti-periodic. So that's why you have here the n plus a half, plus a bar. This comes from the first thing. And then you have this multiplied by 2 pi over t n plus a half plus a bar. And here is what you asked. So maybe I just omitted the I there. And here. And then here, m, okay, the I, remember it's idt, which is the, so, again, this, we have to go through, I don't remember. So you take this product, and this now becomes products of gamma functions. So if you define now,
you can see the black ball.
Okay. So now this becomes Z Pauli Villars of A bar becomes to be the limit of mi goes to infinity, limits of ni goes to infinity, where mi was defined to be mi t over 2 pi, and A, which will come in a moment, is A bar t over 2 pi, and you get this limit, and you have here the gamma function of n2 plus 3 halves plus a divided by the gamma function of minus n1 plus 1 half plus a. And then you have here ratios of n2 plus 3 half plus a plus I m1. And then you have something similar to the power gamma 2, should be n2 plus 3 half plus a plus I n2, this to the power gamma 2, and here you will have the gamma of minus n1 plus 1 half plus a plus I n2. Okay, as I said, nothing is known here about the double scaling limit, if they are needed or not. In any case, this now goes down and becomes the limit of mi goes to infinity of cosine pi a times and you have your cosine of a plus I m2 to the power alpha 2. And from here you get the conditions which I've written up there. And the final, once you take them into account, what do you get? You get 1 plus exponent of I a bar t. What a long way to get such a simple result. But that's the way. And yes, please.
It was a typo on the board upstairs. In the infinite problem, there is alpha 1 and alpha 2 powers which are omitted.
Yes,
it was just.
Yes, here, you mean here?
Yeah, should be to the power alpha 1.
Yeah. Okay, you correct it. Okay, yeah. At least here they were not. So this is the answer that one gets. This answer has two properties. It is invariant under the transformations that remained from A bar. So I remind you, what did A bar need to do? A bar, we were checking, is this invariant under A bar goes to A bar plus 2 pi n over t? It is invariant under that. However, it is not invariant in general for a goes to minus a. So we saw that Pauli-Villars regularization gives you a regularization which is gauge invariant but doesn't work for a equal a bar. You're not invariant under a goes to minus a bar. Okay.
By the way, if one had used the usual 1 half I d by dt both ways, this is the anti-symmetry between psi bar psi dot and psi bar dot psi.
No, would not be you will see where the ordering and tricks of ordering come in. But not at the Lagrangian level.
Because the Lagrangian is not real Hermitian.
Yeah, okay.
If I Hermitianize it explicitly, maybe I get a real.
Well, I think this is a standard Dirac Lagrangian. It's I d slash.
Yeah, but it's modulo surface current. Anyway.
Yeah.
There's a better, which is an issue. Okay. Which I think is a real
part. Okay, we can discuss playing that game. But
which would be cosine, which would be then symmetric.
Well, this one, I chose that one. It has the right, it has the symmetries I wanted, so I can do that. And then we can see what happens if we want to change it. So one thing is, you can ask, how do I make this invariant under a goes to minus a? Okay, that's a legitimate question.
I think that's what Tibor said.
Yeah.
You multiply by the phase and you get cosine.
No, actually, to do that, I need to multiply by a term which is not gauge invariant. I need to add to it a term which is, if I would multiply that by an exponent of minus I a bar t, this, a bar capital T over 2, this would do the job. But this term is not gauge invariant in general under the transformations we have discussed before. It will depend of if n is even or odd. So I can do this, okay? I can try, and this is actually looks like a Chern-Simons term, if you wish. I add, because in this model, this is the Chern-Simons-like term. I add this term, I can correct and now have ZA equals Z minus A, but I have lost, for a general value of N, I have lost the symmetry. So in that case, I have, okay, that, again, it doesn't say that this is the only way to do it. Maybe there are other ways. But this particular way left us with one symmetry and not with the other. You can play around, but I think this is the easiest way to see it, that in order to be able to make it invariant, that is, turn it into a cosine, you had to multiply it by a function which itself is not in general invariant under the global part of the local gauge transformations, not the most general ones. There are some for which it is, let's say half for which it is and half for which it's not. So this is the result that one obtained. If one starts, again, given the time, I won't now show you that, but you can start in a way which ab initio is natural. You are guaranteed at each step that you are going to have charge conjugation. You don't care about gauge invariance, but you do a charge conjugation regularization. It's a little different. And then you indeed get the result that you would get by multiplying these. So you would get that you are, as you are guaranteed at every step, you will also in the limit with charging conjugation invariant, but you are not invariant under the general A, where was it? Not under this general transformation because of this factor 2 which enters in. Okay, so this was an example of how two ways, one which guarantees gauge invariance, which is the Pauli Vilas, which now the file comes back to me. I think the I is what is special about Pauli Vilas. So actually, you put it there. They are not natural fermions because you put the I. That was what Pauli. That was a trick of Pauli and Vilas. And I'm sorry, the file dropped after a while. And on the other hand, if you do, and I didn't show you the natural regularization which obeys charge conjugation, you are going to find out that you obey charge conjugation, guaranteed, but you will miss gauge invariance. Okay, so the first question, it's always terrible, Solomon's choice, whom to choose to sacrifice. And maybe sacrifice both. I mean, who cares about them, actually? Or do I choose one or not the other? This decision cannot be made immediately. It has to be made once A is quantized. If A is not quantized, it's left to the arbitrary will of you. You can keep one, you can keep the other. There are other ways to regularize it, and then you will have neither. Now, let me show you, before we make the Solomon's decision, which in this case is, again, you choose one and not the other, is how would this look in the Hamiltonian formulation? Now, again, I should emphasize that this type of anomaly for decades was missed and actually was discovered by Witten in the mid-80s maybe or something, because for decades nobody realized that this extra imposition is, and it actually gives you a limit on the number of, on the oddness or evenness of neutrinos, for example, that you are allowed to have in your system. So it has consequences. It's here just the quantum mechanical example, but it has more serious consequences. Okay, here, Thibault, I will do what you want. I will take ambiguity in ordering into account. So we know what the classical Hamiltonian is. It's a system which is first time derivative. So you know that when you do the Legendre transform, you will actually not see the conjugate momentum because it's a first time derivative, so it drops. And all you're going to see is back the term you had itself. So the Hamiltonian of the system is going to be I A bar. Okay, but how, in what order? So now that I'm going to quantum mechanics, I know that I can have this, I can write it like this, which is a little bit what you wanted to do, and write it like that, you can.
I don't want the I.
Okay, but
Hamiltonian is Hermitian.
Well, it depends, as you know, on how we decide what, how we do that. So let's not quarrel about that now, even though I agree that out of all numbers, two pi's are less important, I's are crucial. This I would agree. So under the condition that alpha minus beta equals one, I can have any type of combination. They're all legal. They all have the same classical limit. So the problem here, which was the problem of regularization, I had a determinant, it's an infinite product, I have to define it, transmutes into a much simpler problem. I just have the issue of ordering. There's nothing else, there's nothing infinite here, but I do have the ambiguity in how I want to order this. And the results will depend on how I order this, because it multiplies, this will multiply the A bar. And we saw that the gauge dependence will depend on that. So to look at such a Hamiltonian in the general case, yeah. Okay, even in the regularization, you can already see that in order to have one charge conjugation symmetry, for example, that would require that beta equals minus a half. In order to have the symmetry that you change psi and psi, psi dagger and psi and a with minus a. Now, in general, you can now go ahead and calculate the partition function. And the partition function, this operator, psi, dagger, psi, the number operator is two eigenvalues, zero or one. So when writing down the partition function, either the fermion state, either you have a fermion or you don't. And this, you just sum over these two options. And when you do that, that's a very simple thing, you're going to get the exponent of, if I removed alpha and remain with beta, I'm going to get here exponent of minus a bar t times beta times one, which I get when the state is empty. And then I have when the state is full, I would have an exponent of minus a bar t. So this is my partition function. So here, the only ambiguity I had was the ordering. And I have to see, is there a value of beta for which both symmetries can be preserved? I showed you or told you that when you do this transformations, you will get beta equal minus a half, which tells you already that it's not going to be the case that you can keep both. So here, unlike the Lagrangian, where I really had to prove to you that there is no regularization which exists, which can preserve both, here you see, depends what beta you are going to take. You can arrange to get both violated, or you can have one of them. For example, if you took beta equals zero, you would have one of them. If you took beta equal n, you could have the gauge transformation. If you take beta equal minus a half, you got charge conjugation, but you did not get the other symmetry. Okay, so this shows you an example where the Hamiltonian is so much simpler than the Lagrangian. And I wonder, I don't remember, I think Landau suggested to bury the Lagrangian with the honors it deserved, or the one of them was suggested to be buried with the honors it deserves. I think it's the Lagrangian, but it could be the Hamiltonian. In any case, you see that in this particular example, it's really much easier to look at the Hamiltonian formulation. And I'm wondering if there are other systems where you have very complicated calculations doing a Lagrangian, if things could simplify when you look at the subsector just through the Hamiltonian. Okay, now let's make, so here we saw that for gauge invariance, beta should be n. We had a case where n equals zero, but other integer n's would work as well. And the minus a half doesn't work. Now, what about the quantum mechanics? So in the quantum mechanical case, the way this manifests itself is, what is Gauss's law? Now, Gauss's law on the states is obtained by the derivative with respect to the variable which is not cyclic, which is cyclic, which is a naught or a bar here. So Gauss's law would tell you that when acting on the state, let me call it the operator G, which is psi dagger psi plus beta. So when G acts on a state psi, minus beta, I should get zero. That's a claim. That's Gauss's law. Now, in general, we started with the example of beta equal zero, and that was okay. But if I take beta equal minus a half, there is no way I can add fermions and obey this condition. If I take beta equal n, it means my system wouldn't have one fermion, but I would have n and it could work. But for beta equal minus a half, there is nothing I can do, which means my Hilbert space is empty. And this is a manifestation in a Hamiltonian formulation. This is true in higher dimensions. The way that Gauss's law comes, the way you see that in the quantum theory, you cannot give up the symmetry of global transformations is that you will end with an empty Hilbert space. In the Lagrangian formulation, you would integrate what I've written, which was with beta equals zero. This was a partition function. If you integrate it over dA, which a bar, which you should, if it's a functional integral, it would vanish to zero. So there are two ways to see it. In a Lagrangian formulation, where you have a global anomaly, you integrate over the gauge field. When it's quantum, you get zero. So the theory, you don't have a partition function, you can't define anything. It's cleaner to me in the Hamiltonian, my Hilbert space is empty. So I put too much, the system is over-constrained, too bad. So I will have to sacrifice, with great regret, charge conjugation. So the system, even though classically it looked like it had charge conjugation, the consistent quantum theory cannot have charge conjugation. This is the example for the global anomaly. Now, can I give an example of the local anomaly? And this I will do in the 5 minutes which remains. I will, because I can tell you the consequences. So this I cannot do in quantum, we don't know how to do in quantum mechanics, but in a work which I did again with Adam Schwimmer, Ian Halliday, and Mike Chanowitz, we tried to take a model which can be solved exactly, even though it has an anomaly. And that is the Schwinger model in two dimensions. Just go ahead and solve it and see what it gives. Now, the problem, the open problem I have in mind, which I think has not yet been solved, and I wish it, I would have solved it, but if not, someone else solve it, is do non-critical string theory, but don't do the trick of making it critical by adding the appropriate coupling. Leave it non-critical as it is, and quantize it and solve it and see what theory this gives. Because all the way up to now where people did what they call non-critical string theories, but actually completing, canceling the anomaly by adding a piece to the system and then solving it, which is interesting, gives very nice results, but it doesn't face the problem of what happens if you disregard the rules, the authority, and you just do it. And bad things should happen. So let's see how in general one would look, and then look at the two-dimensional case. So what is the general structure that you would expect? So just like you can do with the Willer-DeWitt equation, you can do, or was done much earlier, counting degrees of freedom in the cage of gauge series. So you know you have a gauge object, a mu, which has d degrees of freedom. You can go and forget now the global structure issues, which I discussed, to a gauge where a naught equals zero. So the problem became d minus one. You write down a Hamiltonian, but you find that the generator of gauge transformations, which keep a naught equals zero, which means the time-independent gauge transformations, that generator is just Gauss's law. And let's say the Hamiltonian is e squared plus b squared. G for the free case would just be del dot e. In general, would also have minus some charge density. E and b don't commute because e and a are conjugate variables and a, b is curl of a. But nevertheless, when you do the calculation, because this is the generator of the residual gauge transformations of the system, this will vanish. You do the calculation and you find that H and G vanish, which means that you have the super selection rule, a freedom to diagonalize the two simultaneously. And the way you get the correct number of degrees of freedom, you say, okay, I diagonalize H and I look at all eigenfunctions of H. However, I pick only those eigenvalues, or sorry, only those eigenfunctions which are annihilated, let me call it Gauss's law is better, by Gauss's law. This will be the sector where, for example, Lorentz invariance will be resuscitated, because here I made an explicit breaking of Lorentz invariance. But because the theory is gauge invariant, then if I work at the subset of space of states which are annihilated by G, I look at the spectrum, it is a dispersion, a relativistic dispersion relation. I have resuscitated it, and the number of degrees of freedom went to what it should be, d minus 2. And you can do the same with the Willer-DeWitt equation and go from, in the gravity case, from the number of degrees of freedom embodied in g mu nu, which is d times d plus 1 over 2, reduce it by the same type of operations, go to the synchronous gauge, impose fourth or d type of Gauss's laws, and you will get the same counting. So this works very nice. Is there any loophole in the argument I gave? Yes, there is one loophole. I have assumed that I can simultaneously diagonalize all the g's, which means I've assumed the g of x and g of y vanish for every x and y. If they don't, then I stop there because I cannot diagonalize them at the same time. And the point of anomalies which appear, not the topological ones I've discussed, but the simpler ones which were known for many decades, the ones which are related to gauge transformations which are near the identity is that this doesn't vanish. When you have series where this doesn't vanish, you have an anomaly. Now, where does it come from? It doesn't come from the part del dot E. It comes from the part rho. Now, it's true that in non-abelian gauge theories, like in the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, you don't get that the constraints commute, but you get on this side another constraint. So on the subspace where the constraints vanish, it does commute, and therefore it works well. So if you have a pure gauge theory, let's say just QCD without quarks, there is no problem. There are indeed, there is a I and there is a J, and there will be here a GK, and there will be some FIJKs, or whatever appropriate structure constants, but on the subspace where the G vanishes, they commute, so there's no problem. However, the rho part, this is where the chiral matter comes in, doesn't have that property. There you have derivatives depending on what dimensions you are, but you have delta functions, so derivatives of delta functions, depending again how many derivatives appear, depend on then your dimensionality. And in particular, in two dimensions where you can solve the problem, when you add chiral matter means that ER is different than E left, you're going to get here some, let's say, something which is ER squared minus EL squared multiplied by a derivative of a delta function. So that will be a situation where you have an anomaly. So in general, a lesson to take away independent of the details of the model. The way that the anomaly manifests in a Hamiltonian formulation, if it is the local part of the local group, gauge group, it's the fact that Gauss's laws don't commute. There is a C number, of course, not commute, there is a C number on the right-hand side. On the other hand, when you have a global part of the local gauge group with an anomaly, the Hilbert space is empty. You have over-constrained your system, you will find no state which obeys the laws. So you have to have a theory where this anomaly is cancelled. And you cancel it in string theory, when we have the conformal anomaly. We speak very roughly, we speak about 26 dimensions, we speak about 10 dimensions, we can speak about other ways of doing that. That's the way we cancel the anomaly in string theory. The way you cancel the anomaly in SU5 is by having a 5 bar and a 10. The way you cancel it with gravitational anomalies is by having relations between leptons and quarks. There are many and crucial ways in model building where the anomalies come in. So to conclude, because I didn't, this would have been lecture number 5, which will not happen. So if I would solve this model exactly, it can be done in 2 dimensions. I would solve it in the gauge A0 equals 0. So the first thing is, should I expect a Lorentz invariant dispersion relation? I see no reason. If the theory has an anomaly, if E left is different than ER, there is no reason why the gauge A0 equals 0 would be Lorentz invariant. I picked a direction. And the answer is not Lorentz invariant. You get an explicit dispersion relation. You have in it E related to K to the force n to k squared, so it's not a relativistic dispersion relation, but you can solve the theory exactly. Then just like here you had, both of you suggested to multiply by this, there is a way here to add a Wes-Zumino term to cancel the anomaly. But adding this Wes-Zumino term is always equivalent to having ab initio, another set of fermions which cancel the anomalies, and integrating them out. And the integrating out gives the Wes-Zumino term. There is an ambiguity, and here I'm talking really to the super experts, there is an ambiguity of on gauge invariant terms. The Wes-Zumino term canceling the anomaly is unique. But in the integral, they can also be gauge invariant terms. What do they represent? There are infinite number of ways to cancel an anomaly. If E right is different than E left, I can have an infinite number of distribution of charges which I add to my theory, each of which will end up exactly canceling the anomaly. Okay, for example, let's say that ER minus E left was 1. Okay, so I need to add an E left, which is 1. But I can add E left, which is 3. And then I can add an E right, which is 2. Or I can add 2 E rights, which are 1. There are an infinite number of ways to cancel the anomaly by adding extra stuff, which is not anomalous. Okay, you just pick up the single part, which is... And that's what the gauge invariant terms reflect, and it's an interesting thing to know. And then the final surprise I had on the subject is there are in conformal field theories what are known as coset models. Coset models are models which are very interesting because in string theory they can replace geometry by algebra. And you can do exact calculations using the algebra instead of living with a semi-classical picture, which is geometry. So they have had, and I think will have, and are having lots of uses. Now, if you take a model which has a Wessel-Minow-Witten model G, it has a subgroup H, and you write the Sugawara construction as a different of the Gs and the Hs, this model itself is not a WZW model, but still is conformal, and its conformal charge is the difference of these two. And we have shown in the past with Korkut-Bardacci that this model can be written as a gauged, as a strong coupling limit of a gauged Wessel-Minow-Witten model. And you can see exactly how this model constructs. Now, the funny part is that if we have a group G over H, for cosets, so that's a strong coupling limit, that's a deep infrared of the problem, we found that actually you can gauge, I thought for years that I cannot gauge an anomalous symmetry. In this cases, you can gauge the anomalous symmetry, and actually you find the relativistic dispersion relation, which was to me a surprise. So again, these models you take by writing down some CFT, gauging that CFT, but not adding a term F squared. The term F squared in two dimensions has conformal weight. So if conformal invariance is not spontaneously broken, it will not be created, and indeed it's not created. But you could think also of the model with the F squared, and then just take the coupling, which is dimensionful, like the mass, to infinity. It's the same consequence. And in that case, as I told you, somehow this anomalous Schwinger model remains with a relativistic spectrum, which to me is a little bit of a puzzle how that could have happened. So I think by giving puzzles which are concrete, and in the beginning telling you about an area which I find really very interesting and I believe will develop well, there will be interesting results, but in which things are not as well defined as we would like, and one needs much better definitions, which is a quantum information theory related to gauge theories and to gravity. I hope I gave you some feel of that. And I hope by this I finished my duties here on that. And the next Louis Michel professor will have to do the same now. Okay.